for this episode, you join me here at Gold Valley on the Middle Lake on peg 74. It's a bitterly, bitterly cold day, and I actually got here just after 6 in the morning just to check the lake wasn't frozen. It's been that cold. The water's dropped right down to just over 5 degrees, and that only means one thing, that the fish are going to be very, very hard to catch. I've sat on peg 74 because it's got a little bit of form on the pole in the slightly warmer months, and if we're going to catch anywhere, it'll be here. Also, it's the widest part of the lake, which allows me to demonstrate to you the way that I go about fishing a little maggot feeder for these really wary F1s and skimmers. So why have I come here and what do I want to show you? It's very, very important to me in all my fishing to share things with people that obviously I think make a massive difference to me. As you all know, like those of you that get the e-mag and look at all the articles and the videos I do, for carp, I'm talking about the big commons and mirrors like in Gold Lake or Syndicate or various other venues up and down the country, I don't scale down. Obviously fishing light for those sort of fish only means one thing, and that is you're going to lose more. However, lessons were definitely learnt with me at the back end of last year. Fishing here at Gold Valley, I had a fantastic run when it was pellets, fishing 012, 014. Come the first winter league, I got absolutely hammered. I only beat two or three people in my section. And then I knew it was time to look, learn and definitely change. And what I did then, in the couple of weeks after that, was talking to people that fish for F1s quite a bit in the winter. I'm a little bit guilty, I've fished a lot for F1s in the warmer months. In the winter, not so often. But now we've got a big head of them in a couple of the lakes here at Gold Valley. It was so important that I learned where I'd gone wrong. Like I say, I had a fantastic run, framed in nearly 20 matches. Come the winter league, when the water temperature had dropped, I got absolutely hammered. And that was down to a few things. Fishing too heavy, feeding too aggressive, and feeding the wrong baits. I was feeding pellets and micros, fishing too heavy, fishing too short, and waiting for the fish to come to me. And it had changed. It was about fishing with maggots, about fishing long. The feeder started playing a part. And 100%, and the biggest thing I'm going to demonstrate and show you today, is fishing light. Now a lot of you might say, yeah, I fish light, I fish 012, 014, maybe even 016. I'm talking light. I'm talking 08, 09 fluorocarbons to 20s, 20, 22 hooks, very, very small wire hooks. And this does sound small, but with light elastic like yellow hydro on the pole, it's well balanced and you can land these fish. Like I've already said, if it was big carp, there's no way I'd be scaling down that light. But with these F1s and skimmers, it definitely makes a difference, not just here, but all over the country fishing for these F1s and these skimmers. After the winter league, when I did quite poorly, I went out and I fished a couple of afternoons and I put it right. Not just catching fish on light line, but learning to play the fish on light lines, taking my time, not feeding hardly anything, half a pint to a pint of maggots the whole day, including the feeder line. Obviously my approach changed from fishing close to fishing long, starting at 14.5 metres. So two long lines at 14.5 metres, 10 o'clock and 2 o'clock. And this just gives me the option of just switching from one line to the other. You're only looking for 20 to 30 fish to catch 30 to 40 pound, and that's a match winning bag at the moment. Yes, every now and then they do shoal up and you can catch a real big weight, but to frame and win money, 30 pound plus is the weight I'm looking for. So anywhere around 25, 30, 35 fish and you're in with a good shout. As far as the pole's concerned, with it being this cold, what I'm going to do today is start on the pole and just see if there's any fish there. But I'm not going to give it too long. I'm going to assess the situation quite quick. Any liners, any bites or any bubbles that are signs of fish, then I might well stay on the pole a bit longer. But I'm looking at giving it 20, 25 minutes. If I don't get bites, I'm out on the feeder. Today's session is to show you how I go about fishing very light and really trying to get across how important I think this is. Small hooks, light line, and also on the pole coupled with very, very small floats. 4x12 floats I'm using, nicely strung out with number 10 shot, a nice slow fall, and a lot of those bigger F1s and those decent skimmers take it as soon as it hits the bottom. Now, obviously, I've touched on fishing 08, 09 on the feeder. Now, a lot of you will think, blimey, these F1s, they virtually pull the rod in, you know, you're going to get snapped on the bite. With the rig I'm going to show you, this isn't the case. So what have I changed? The 10-foot rods have gone out the window, especially for these F1s. I still use them for carp, but for F1s, 11-foot. Why? It just gives me that extra foot of rod that absorbs those bites. When I'm fishing light, I can get that bend in the tip on the bite, and it's just going to absorb the bite and stop me from getting snapped on the bite. Slightly lighter mainline, 6-pound hypersensor mainline. I've got an 8-pound fluorocarbon shock leader that's only 6 foot long. But probably the most important thing in the rig is something I learned from one of my Hungarian friends, Tamás Walter, on a feeder festival I fished at Barston late last year. And it's incorporating around about 6 inches of 6-pound Drenon power gum into the rig. And it is something that I'll show you in depth as the session goes on. But trust me, this rig is worth its weight in gold. It's not only caught me a lot of fish because I'm able to fish lighter than a lot of other people fishing conventional feeder rigs, but it saved me at times when I'm a bit guilty of looking around the lake, I've not had a bite for 15, 20 minutes, you look round and the rod's round, 99 times out of 100 without that power gum, that fish would have snapped you. And it's not only the fish you've lost, it's the disturbance that's been caused by that fish taking the bait. You've lost the fish, you've caused disturbance. Not with this rig. The rod's round, you pick up, basically like you're fishing with braid. You just pick the rod up, you're not striking, you're picking the rod up and you're starting to play the fish. There's very, very few things in fishing now that make me stand up and pay attention. And believe me, this rig is definitely one of them. And fishing light for F1s is definitely another. And that's the thing with fishing, you've got to learn, you've got to take on board little rigs, little tips, little things people are doing. You're going to have bad days and you're going to have good days. Every day to me is a good day now, as long as I take something away from that session, take something away from that match. In a way, that Winter League, the first one I fished when I only beat two or three in the section, do you know what? I'm glad that happened because it made me go away, think about my fishing and learn. And that is the most important thing. And that's the reason I'm here today, to show you how I go about fishing light. As far as the tackle's concerned today, obviously the water clarity's gone, the water temperature's dropped right down, the fish are at distance. If I was a betting man, I'd say we're not going to catch on the pole to begin with, but it could be okay late on. So what have I done? I've put up two rigs, both identical, in case of a breakage. Luckily on this peg, it's the same depth, 10 o'clock and 2 o'clock, absolutely identical. If there was a difference in depth, then I would definitely put two rigs up to make sure that obviously I'm fishing bang on dead depth. And by that I mean the body and the bristle. As you all know, that's how I plumb up. One little trick when you have to do this, like I say, luckily today I don't, take a Tippex pen, just mark on the bottom of your pole, left, right, so you don't get confused. Obviously if one side's 2 inches deeper than the other and you get those rigs mixed up, you're fishing over depth on one and off bottom on the other. So just put an L and an R, and that just makes it so simple. Just at a glance, you can see what rig is what. It's only a small tip, but it's something that I use quite a lot in these circumstances. So going back to the rig, as I've already said, it's a very, very light float. It's a 4x10 Team Darwa 11. Very short float, carbon stem, very, very fine, but sensitive bristle. So it's quite a fine hollow tip. So again, a slightly longer line between float and tip. This is because we're not looking at fishing right on the bait. We're not looking at getting one every chuck like in the summer on pellet short. We're looking at just flicking the rig out, a nice slow drop, almost like roach fishing. And some of you may have noticed or seen a comment that I made earlier or late last year that F1s are the new roach. And I didn't mean that they were replacing the roach. What I meant was I'm fishing for them how I fish for roach. Nice yellow elastic sets off for a long puller kit. Again, I'm steering clear when it's colder and the fish are on the back foot and I'm getting less bites. A longer kit gives me more elastic, more security. I could be hooking bream, might even hook an odd carp, but a little bit more elastic just gives me that bit of security. Now, one little tip when you're fishing these light floats is to drop the main line down. I'm only fishing an 08 hook length and a 20 hook on this rig. So I've dropped the main line down to 012. And that isn't for any other reason than when you're using these light floats, any heavier line and the line tends to pull the float in and out with any drift or wind. Dropping it down to 012, I've still got quite a bit of durability. The hook length of 08 is going to break well before the main line. But what it does, it just gives the float that bit of freedom, and the main line's not going to be pulling it off. If you start using 016, 014 line on these little floats, obviously then any kind of wind or drift and your float's going to be pulled off of line with the thickness of your main line. Completely different to the summer style staggered bolt pellet rig that we're used to using. Very close, getting it down. Really, like, if you miss a bite, rig relocation fast is of utmost importance. That's gone out the window. Just a little staggered bulk, around about 3 to 4 inches apart. And what you'll notice is that I start the first shot not that far away from the float. And this gives the small floats stability. The last thing you want to do is have everything bunched up down the bottom, because then you've got a lot of line between the float and the first shot. And that can make the float a little bit unstable. And with these small floats, just by starting around about 2/3 of the way up to the float, just gives the float that little bit more stability. I've got a few little tuning styles there. Again, I want to dot that float right down. A lot of these F1s and these skimmers, it's almost like a little wobble on the float rather than going under. And you want to be striking at every little indication. You can see there the white mark on the pole top. I've got the body and the bristle over depth. Absolutely perfect today, because left and right lines are exactly the same. The hook length is 5 inches of 09 Drennan fluorocarbon and a size 20 Guru Maggot F1. Absolutely perfect hook. The only other hook that I do use is a size 16 Green Gamma. This is if I'm using double maggot, single maggot today, or single maggot and a pinky. But the bait is something else I want to talk to you about. So let's get the tackle done first. So I've got two rigs identical. You'll see on the one that I'm actually going to start on, I've got a little tiny kinder pot. I can just drop a few maggots in and literally sprinkle 5 or 6 maggots on each line and just see. With the lid on the pot, it enables me to sprinkle a few in one line, move to the other, sprinkle a few in there. Or likewise, if I start catching, I can sprinkle 3 or 4 in, lay my rig in. If I don't get a bite, sprinkle 2 or 3 more in, lay my rig in. And by keeping the lid on the pot, it enables me to keep some maggots in. Don't worry if you strike and some maggots fly out. A little bit of an area is not a problem. What I'm trying to get at is you're not trying to build an area like we were in the summer when the fish were really rampant and it was about catching 100, 150 pound. You're not looking at building that area up and fishing in that bait box on the bottom. Forget that. You're looking at a little bit of an area of bait, not a lot of bait, a little light airy-fairy rig, and that's what's going to get us some bites today, I'm sure. I've got two rigs identical, just in case of a breakage. That one's all plumbed up. They're both ready to go. It's fantastic that it is the same depth, 10 o'clock and 2 o'clock, but definitely if you've got a variation in depth, put two rigs up. Get that depth dead right. Don't want to be losing fish, foul hooking fish, missing bites because you've made do with the depth. Don't be lazy. Put those two rigs up. Like I say, if you're lucky enough to draw a peg and it's flat like it is here today, then you can get away with one rig. The margin rigs, the top 4, top 5, top 6 rigs have gone out the window. The water clarity has gone. The temperature, I've got my thermometer in now, it's 5.4. It's come up 0.2 of a degree since I've set up, so that's good. Probably a little bit of sun, not too much wind hitting the water is going to bring that temperature up a tiny bit. Now, on to the rig. And this is the one that I really wanted to bring the cameras to see. And that is my new feeder rig. Or should I say, not my new feeder rig, but Tamas Walters' rig that he showed me. So like I've already gone over, 11-foot rod. That extra foot just absorbs those bites from those big F1s or the skimmers. A little bit more bend in the rod gives me a bit more security. I've dropped the main line down from 8-10 pound down to 6 pound hypersensor. And as you might well be able to see, I've got about 6 foot of 020 fluorocarbon there. That just gives everything a heavy feel and also just makes that last 6 foot of the rig invisible. Basically, to create the rig, you've got a free running feeder. I've tied a swivel onto the fluorocarbon and put a float stop over the end of the swivel. Then I've attached 5 or 6 inches of the 6 pound Drennan power gum and tied a knot in it. Then you can just use your normal hook lengths, loop it over, basically how you'd attach your pole rig to elastic if you're using a crow's foot, and everything locks. It's so neat, it's so simple, but it is so effective. Anything that enables me to fish 09, 08 hook lengths on the feeder this time of year is a plus, because believe me, it does get you more bites. Okay, if you're on an absolute pile of F1s, you will catch some on 013, 015. But trust me, not just in matches, but obviously coming out here practicing pleasure fishing, it definitely makes a difference. I had a fantastic run just before Christmas, catching half my fish on the feeder, half my fish on the pole. I run 5 out of 6 matches that I've fished from a variety of pegs on the lake. It wasn't the pegs. Definitely fishing light has made a difference. People do get confused. I say to people, yeah, I'm fishing really light on middle. And they're like, yeah, so am I. I've fished 012 today. And I'm like, 012? No, light. I'm fishing 08, 09. The only reason I don't fish lighter is because I think 07, 06, and you're going to lose fish, definitely. 08 definitely seems to be the borderline. 09 is definitely my favourite, the 09 Suplex fluorocarbon. Slightly stronger than it looks, it mics up exact, it ties nice, and it's just that little bit robust. I will show you the rig in more detail a little bit later, but the day's getting on. I want to get in on the pole and just see if we can get some bites. If not, I want to establish myself on the feeder. Now, one thing that we all know with F1s is that they can be in your peg, but you won't know it. You're fishing in the wrong place. The pole today, I'm going to start 10 o'clock, 2 o'clock. I'm literally going to drip in 6 or 7 maggots on each. And if I don't get any indications, I'm just going to leave it and come back to it later in the session. The biggest mistake people make when they're fishing for F1s on the feeder is they go to the extreme of their peg. Here at Gold Valley, in a lot of commercials, you've got ropes or borders down the middle where you can go to. And my advice is to start 2/3 of the way to this. Give yourself that third of the lake that is left virgin, it's left untouched. No one has cast there, and the fish can back off. And what you'll see me doing today is I'll cast out, and if I don't get any bites, I'll just literally take off 2 metres of the clip and cast back out. And I'll be just moving past. Likewise, if I cast out and we catch a couple and it goes a little bit quiet, then I'll move past. And I'm just giving myself an option of going further and further and further. We all know in the winter the best way to get a bite on the pole, 9 times out of 10, is to put another section on and go past where you've been fishing. And that's exactly what I'm trying to duplicate on the feeder. We've spoke in the past, if you know how to feed on the pole, duplicate it and do it on the feeder, because if it's right on the pole, it's right on the feeder. And that's exactly what I'm trying to tell you today. Fishing light on the pole definitely gets you more bites, so it's going to on the feeder, duplicate it. But obviously you've got to do a few little tweaks to your gear to make sure that you're not going to get broke on the bite. The day's getting on a little bit. It's still bitterly cold, and I think we're going to have to put a little bit of work in to get a few bites. So I've shown you the gear. I'm just going to run over the bait quickly, although it is very, very simple. Because it's cold and the fish are on the back foot, I've literally done a few micro pellets that I've just soaked up. I might put a few of these in my feeder if I'm catching an odd skimmer, or if there's an odd carp about. But I always like to soak some up, even if I don't think I'm going to use them. The beauty is with a maggot feeder, you can do anything with it. You can put a little bit of ground bait in it, you can put micro pellets, you can put pinkies, you can put maggots, or you can put nothing. I'm going to start today by literally putting in 5 or 6 maggots and just taking it nice and nice and slow. As far as the maggots are concerned, now this is a massive, massive thing for me. You can see here I've bought a couple of pints of maggots, which is more than enough for today's session. A nice big fresh maggots, but the one thing you'll notice is that they're red. I've got an odd bronze maggot and a very, very odd fluorescent maggot in it. Now, a lot of you might be thinking, why just red? With the water clarity gone, my thinking is that if I'm going to introduce ground bait, black ground bait is best. I'm not going to introduce a white or a light brown coloured ground bait, because I know the fish aren't going to come over it in clear, cold water. And my thinking is exactly the same with maggots. Why would I want to introduce white maggots and have white maggots on the bottom? Bearing in mind in this temperature, they're going to go to the bottom, they're going to be pretty dormant, inactive, and they're going to lay there. And since I've just been using red maggots, I've definitely caught more fish and had more fish in my peg. So it's just a little tip, keep everything dark, keep everything low, just keep everything sort of in stealth mode. You're fishing light, you're trying not to feed much, you're trying to feed colours that the fish are going to accept. I know a few of the top anglers have been doing this for a little bit, and it's something that I've started doing here at Gold Valley and on a couple of other venues, and it's definitely made a little bit of a difference to me. There's nothing white on the bottom, everything's dark, everything's in stealth mode, and that's exactly the way I want it. What I have bought, I've literally got a quarter of a pint of pinkies, fluoro pinkies with a few red. Don't know what it is about fluoro pinkies, but over the years, you know, right back, I can think back to when I fished for Farmer when I was 12, 14, 15, going fishing with my dad, fluoro pinkies just gets you bites, and it's no different now. When you get a few fish in your peg and you get little indications and it's not really happening, a red maggot with a fluoro pinky can just get you bites. It really is one of those baits that I depend on. It's a bit like bread punching the winter on canals, it'll get you bites. It's a bit like bloodworm and joker in the winter for roach, it'll get you bites. Fluoro pinkies on these kind of venues, when you're targeting F1s, small carp and skimmers, it will get you a bite or two when other baits tend to fail. As far as the side tray is concerned today, very simple. One or two people might well ask, why no dead maggots? When it's this cold, I'm hardly feeding anything. It doesn't even worry for me if a few maggots go into the silt. I know the fish will know that they're there. For some reason, they do know. And it's just a case of having everything live, everything fresh, giving myself the best opportunity of getting some bites. The water temperature's just above 5, which is bitterly cold, and it is borderline. The fish might well be a little bit shoaled up, which can happen on commercials. Everything's live today. I've got a few fluoro pinkies, some maggots. Everything's live, because I'm not going to be feeding a lot, and I just want utmost attraction. I want a little bit of movement in my bait. I want a little bit of the bright colour with the fluoro pinkies. I don't want anything white on the bottom that I think is going to like scare the fish. Bearing in mind, you know, a lot of my fishing is done on the international scene. Fishing for roach, fishing for skimmers, fishing for carp on big waters that are predominantly clear water. And the colour of ground bait makes a massive difference. Makes a difference between catching and not. So the colour of your maggots is something that I spend, or I put a lot of thought into. And I'm convinced that using a darker coloured maggots all round is exactly the same, gives me the same advantages as using a black ground bait or a black lean. I haven't mixed any ground bait up today. I know at this temperature it's going to be maggots. When I'm talking about my maggots, we get a delivery here on a Friday morning, and I like the biggest, plumpest, freshest maggots. You know, I was brought up fishing with bloodworm, joker, worms, maggots, and trust me, any live bait, it works better when it's fresh. It's got more appeal, it's got more of its natural smell. Obviously, if I'm bleak fishing, I want tough pinkies. If I'm, you know, fishing for a ridiculous amount of fish, you want extra tough maggots. But we're here in January, the water's 5 degrees, and we're fishing for wary, wary fish that I know respond to very fresh, you know, almost brand new bait. You smell the maggots when they come in straight from the maggot farm. They've got that real ammonia, fishy sort of smell. And I'm convinced that's what the fish like. I put hardly any maize with them, just enough to keep them nice and almost dry. I don't want to take any of the natural sort of smell away. Always use and look for the nice, big, lively maggots with that nice, big feed spot in them, and you won't go far wrong. It's a pretty simple day as far as the baits are concerned, but trust me, with the rigs I'm going to show you today, especially the feeder rig, and the way I go about feeding virtually nothing, I think it's going to be an interesting day. We're going to get started and see if we can get a few bites. Well, there we go. We've been fishing about 15 minutes. And to say you couldn't write it would be an understatement. I've literally sat there and I'm thinking, right, I'm going to have to go on the feeder. Everything's telling me that I'm not going to catch on the pole. And I saw the minutest of bubbles around about a foot past where I've sprinkled in those six or seven maggots. And I've just waited and waited and waited, because patience is a massive thing when it's this cold. And a little dink on the float, and that's our first fish of the day. Nice chunky F1, hooked just inside the mouth. I used my disgorger that was on the platform when I got here. It's my new lucky one. That tiny hook, absolutely perfect. It's like a block of ice, this fish. I can't tell you how cold it is. But fantastic fishing. 09 fluorocarbon hook length, 20 hook. That was on double red maggot. Reason I started on double maggot is because quite often early in the session, especially when you sprinkle a little bit of bait in, only five or six maggots, I want a standout bait, I want a big bait. Quite often single maggot and a pinky can work when the fish have arrived, but to get that first fish, quite often double maggot is a real good bait. You'll also notice when I'm feeding is I'm not just tipping it down the same hole like we would do when it's warmer. I'm actually sprinkling it from about 2 meters up, just to get those six or seven maggots just sprinkled in a little area. That way that, you know, if you do get some wary fish coming your peg, they're not on a pole, there's a little bit of an area for them to graze over. And that's exactly what I'm trying to achieve. So what I'm going to do now, I'm absolutely over the moon that we caught that fish. What's different today is if I start catching on the pole and it was a match, I would just stay on the pole and I'd leave the rest of my peg completely untouched, and you just get waves of fish coming in. And sometimes when you catch early on the pole, you can catch on and off all day. By not putting pressure on your peg, you just get that constant supply of fish dripping in. Obviously today we're here practicing, doing a little bit of filming. So I will be at some stage trying the feeder and obviously demonstrating to you the feeder rig. You see I've got two maggots on there, they're nice and lively. They won't be so lively when they've been in there for a little bit. And what I'm going to do, I'm not going to count exactly, but around about 12, 14 maggots. You can see always around about 12 or 14 maggots. One little tip, always use an oversized pot. That way when you're shipping out, you're not going to get any spillages or anything. And what I'll do is, I'm literally going to ship out to where I've caught that fish. Hold the pole around about 2 meters off the water. And just count in half of them maggots. And then I'm going to put the other half on my other line. There you go. Fantastic to catch an F1 that early. I've got to be honest, I thought if we did catch early, it would probably be a skimmer or a bream. By fishing light, fishing that tiny little float, nice balanced tackle, you can get those bites when people fishing slightly heavier, they won't get a sign from a fish. So like I say, I'm constantly looking for any giveaway signs, not just bites or liners on the floats, but any little bubbles, any movements that could be fish. It's like then I'd virtually, probably a bit too soon, I'd started in my head to write the pole off until later on today. Maybe the last hour we'd get some bites on it. And I literally saw around about 30 to 40 centimetres past the float, a bubble, which to me is an absolute dead giveaway that there's a skimmer or an F1 or one of the small carp in my peg. So again, like you would do on the feeder, if you're getting indications and signs of fish, you just sit and wait and wait and wait. And that's exactly what I did. Tiny little dink resulted in that F1, which is absolutely fantastic. Obviously today there's no tow. If there were any tow, just follow the tow, let your float go with the tow. A lot of the fish will be downstream, a bit like fishing a river. But one thing I've found, the F1s, they tend not to like the tow that much. And on windy days when there is a bit of tow, especially on this lake, the fish seem to be at distance, and that's when the feeder can definitely play more of a part on those windy days. You get these flat days when there's no tow, and the pole tends to be the best method. Now, a lot of people say to me, you know, about lifting and dropping. I'm not a massive fan of it. What I will do, though, is lift the whole rig out and put it in again so I get that hole full through the water. I don't want to be sitting there jigging my float around almost like we're fishing chopworm. I want to be sitting there nice and patient. When I've been patient or I think that there's a fish in the peg and I just want to create that full, I literally lift the whole rig out, put my hook bait just past my pole tip, locate the float, and let the whole rig just flutter down again. So I've got the hole full to make that fall as natural as possible. I've not just lifted it 4 inches off the bottom and dropped it back down again. It's something I've tried and I've not had a lot of bites fishing like that. Coupled with fishing light, the number one thing that you need this time of year is patience. You need to be able to sit and wait. It's a little bit easier when you're fishing a feeder to sit and wait than it is with the pole, because with the pole you think you should be lifting and dropping and this, that and the other. But trust me, you know, if you get signs of fish like I did then with that little bubble, just sit and wait and wait and wait. And I almost, you never know in fishing, but I almost said to myself, I'm going to get one in a minute, and I did, you know. So there's been no other bubbles, no other signs of fish, so that could have just been a one-off, just a little bit of a loner away from a shoal of fish. But what it is, it's a fantastic sign that, one, they're feeding in this cold weather, and two, that, you know, normally with F1s they're a little bit like roach. When you get one, you normally get one or two more. So fingers crossed we will get some bites. I'm obviously not going to just sit here and wait and wait and wait. I will be going on that feeder if I don't get another bite in the next 15-20 minutes. But what that F1's done is just buy me a little bit more time before I go on that feeder. And quite often, the longer you can leave that feeder, the more productive it is. Other people are casting out, spooking fish. Yeah, they might be catching fish, but they'll push the fish into an area where nobody's fishing. There's no line going through the water. And quite often, and I've had it here a few times lately in matches where I've managed to winkle a few fish out on the pole, kept it going, and then it's gone funny. And I'm almost the last one to go out on the feeder, and my peg's absolutely solid with them, where they've gone to a bit of water where nobody's fishing, there's no line, there's no feeders landing, and they've got comfy there, and you chuck out, and you have a real good end to the match. Likewise, I've gone in on the pole in matches and not caught, gone out on the feeder, caught, and then caught late on the pole. But the one thing you have to remember, and it's again where a lot of people go wrong with F1s, is if you go in on the pole and you don't catch, don't go putting a pot full of bait in, you know. Just leave it, just neglect it, and the fish will come in onto that line if they want to. All I do is, if I'm catching a few fish on the feeder, every half hour, 40 minutes, I literally shake in 6 or 7 maggots on each line, just to keep something there. I want to underfeed it by a long way rather than overfeed it. All this putting bait in and letting them turn up, it doesn't happen with F1s. And for some reason, the bream feed very, very similar. As you can see now, I've been on that left-hand line. When I did top it up, I tapped some maggots in on my right-hand line, so I can just alternate between the two. If it was a difference in depth, the only difference is I'd have to come in and obviously swap my rig over, but that's not a hardship. You're talking minimum, you know, just a few seconds just to come in, change the rig over and go from there. What you will notice is how low I've got the float shotted, and again, that there's a very, very good reason for that, and that is the fact that a lot of these bites will be tiny, tiny little dinks on the float. You know, that F1 I caught, I've got the float dotted right down, and it was more of a wobble than a than an under. And if you haven't got your float shotted that low, it's going to be very, very hard for you to see those bites. Not just from the F1s, but from the skimmers as well. You know, they're moving so slow when the water's this cold. Just tiny, tiny little dinks can result in a nice size fish. Just going to lift my float there. Now, I lifted it then, not really to activate the bait or anything, but my float was just slightly offline and I just want to get it back online. Not looking to hold it still, but I'm just looking to control it. There's no tow, so I don't really need to control it over the line. And all the time I'm just looking for telltale signs of fish, bubbles, indications on the floats, bites, even fish topping. One definite tip is, you know, if you do see fish topping and you can't catch on the pole, is to cast your feeder towards them. Again, be mindful of the fact you don't want to max out, you don't want to go to the extreme length of your peg, because then you've got nowhere really to go. And it's very, very rare on these venues that by dropping short you start to catch. By going further, you nearly always catch. But by dropping short after fishing long, you very, very rarely catch. Once they've moved out, it's very rare in the match that they come back in. A little bit different, they can turn up in on the pole. That's completely different, but I'm talking about that feeder. They tend to back away from it rather than come your side of it. No indications there. Just going to lay the whole rig in again. And again, just being patient. But having caught a few fish on this in recent weeks, you do get a few indications, as in bubbles, when you've got fish in your peg. And it really is a giveaway. This little area of Middle Lake, the bottom's quite soft, which is why I think it's good when the water is this cold. But also, what's nice when you get a soft bottom is the fact that the fish will activate the bottom and you will see odd little bubbles, which again is, you know, a bit of a giveaway that there's fish there. So always be, there we go, there's a fish. I never had a sign then, no bubbles, nothing. But by lifting that float and laying it in again and getting that natural fall all the way down, that had literally been on the bottom for a matter of seconds and it was under and we're into a fish. Really taking my time. Even though that yellow hydro works perfectly with 010, 09, 08 hook lengths, it's absolutely fine. I'm in no risk of that line breaking whatsoever. Taking my time. Just a fantastic start to the session. It is a skimmer actually, which is good. Even when I've caught these big weights of 50, 60 pounds on the matches that I've won here, you always get a few skimmers mixed in. And I don't know what it is with skimmers and F1s, but they tend to really feed well together. Didn't feel like a bream when I hooked it, but for some reason bream and F1s go really well together. Fantastic fish, nice young fish. One of the maggots has come off, but hooked perfectly in the top lip there. That tiny little hook just nestled in there. Beautiful fish. It just goes to show that fishing light isn't just about F1s, but it will get you more bites off fish like this. And like I said, I've in the weights that I've caught here to win matches, a percentage of those weights are bream. So you can't discount them totally. They're worthwhile fish. You see that fish round about £2. Now what I'm going to do now, and the beauty is with these pots, is you can vary how you feed. So what I'm going to do now, again, not going to count exactly, around about 12 to 14 maggots. I've caught that fish on the right hand line, and what I'm going to do now is go out onto the right hand line, shake 5 or 6 maggots in, then I'm going to go onto my left hand line, but I'm not going to feed. I'm going to give it a couple of minutes. If I don't get a bite, then the 5 or 6 maggots that are left in the pot, I can shake on that line and go back onto the fed area to the right. So what I'm saying is, you know, by accurate fishing, nice and positive fishing, using that slightly bigger pot, you can actually leave a few maggots in the pot whilst you're fishing another line. So here we go, this is the plan. I've just caught a fish off the right hand line. So I'm literally going to shake 5 or 6 maggots in on that line, leaving a few maggots in my pot. I'm going to go onto my left hand line. Now I'm not going to shake them in to begin with. I'm going to fish for 2 or 3 minutes and just see if there's a fish over the bait that I tapped in there around about 10 minutes ago. If not, I can feed and I can go back onto the right hand line and see if a fish has come to the bait that we've just put in. One little tip if you're going to do this, and it is a deadly way of fishing two lines, is try and keep your pole pot dry. Because the minute that it gets wet, the minute you dunk it in the water, the maggots get wet and they're going to crawl up the side of the pot, and it's going to be virtually impossible to keep the maggots in the pot on the line that you don't want to feed yet. You can see those maggots, they're still in the pot. You can see the little shade of red in that pot where the maggots have stayed in there. If I do get a bite and I strike and the maggots come out, I'm not too worried about that. There's only 5 or 6 maggots in there, and if they go off at a slight angle, it's not a problem. I know where I'm fishing, I know where I'm actually going to be targeting those fish. And if a few maggots do come out in a different area, it's not the end of the world. If anything, it's creating a slightly bigger area for those fish to graze over. I don't want loads of maggots in different areas, I'll try not to do it. But if that float goes under, I'm going to strike properly, try and set that hook. Really is a fantastic way of fishing, being able to really alter and be choosy when you feed your peg. Being able to feed one line, go on the other, just swap and change and alternate. And also it gives you the heads up, you know, the fish coming to bait. For instance, if I tap these maggots in now, go on the right hand line and I get a bite immediately, I know, hang on a minute, I've only just fed that line and the fish are coming to bait. Likewise, if I don't, I can think to myself, okay, next time I catch a fish, I'm not going to feed. I'm just literally going to go back out there and see if there's another fish there, because the fish aren't coming to bait. It's just trying to find a way this time of year of winkling out 15, 20, 25 fish in a 5-hour match. And if you can do that, you're going to end up with the sort of weight that you need to do well in the match. It's not any case of you thinking, oh, I've got to force it, I've got to put a lot of bait in, I'm behind, I've got to do this, I've got to do that. The most important decisions you're going to have to make is when you go on the feeder, when you decide to actually take that plunge to go out into the body of your peg. In an ideal world, you start catching on the pole and you don't go out there and you get those fish coming in all the time. There you go, there's another bite. Now what I'm going to do, because my pole tip's over it, I'm just going to shake those maggots in. And you can see now the sort of rhythm and that you can get in. And a lot of it's down to pole control. Once you get used to fishing and you can handle your pole properly, you handle the pot properly, you can do little things like that. It's a case of practice. I'm sure that this one's an F1. Again, I'm just taking my time. I've got that little tiny hook on. Yeah, nice big F1. There you go. Absolute perfect example of what I'm talking about. Nice big F1. You can see that tiny little hook just nestled right in its top lip. They can be a bit stubborn opening their mouths, which is why most of the time I'll use a disgorger. Even if I can see the hook, they're a little bit like Daddy Rough. They don't want to open their mouths, but probably a 2-pound fish. Absolutely lovely. See how I'm alternating the pegs and putting odd fish in the net. And the best thing about it is we haven't even ventured out into the actual body of the peg yet. We've been fishing for a while now, and to be fair, we've caught three or four F1s and a couple of skimmers. And the fishing was quite good to begin with when it was flat calm. But we've got this southwesterly wind got up that's coming off our back that's created a little bit of movement. And the last half hour or so, I've not had a single sign. So what I'm going to do in a minute, I'm going to make the move and fish a, go out on a feeder about two-thirds of the way to the rope. You might have noticed or remember when I said at the when I did the talk at the start, normally these F1s, they don't like the movement, they don't like tow. And as soon as it started moving, I had just haven't had a bite, and I think the fish have gone out. Obviously on a round to oblong shaped lake, the nearer the middle you get, the less tow there's going to be. And I think them fish have gone out. I saw one top about 20 minutes ago in the peg to my right. So they could well have gone out. But what I'm not going to do is put loads of bait in before I go out there on the pole. I'm literally going to drip in a dozen maggots, which is a little bit more than I've been putting in. And while I'm on the feeder, just every 30, 40 minutes, just put a few in. Because it could happen again on the pole. I'm convinced it is the tow. Because on quite a few matches I've fished here recently, once that tow starts, the fish seem to go out, and it's no surprise that as that tow started, as the wind's got up, that the bites on the pole have really just completely dropped off, because it was a good start. You know, we probably caught 10 pounds in the first 50 minutes on the pole. Now I think it's time to chase the fish a little bit. There's only so long in a match that you can wait for the fish to come to you. So I'm going to start on double red maggot. Just pop that landing net out the way. Beautiful maggots this time of year. So big and fresh. I've got the smallest Drennan feeder on, and I've actually cut a little slit in the feeder, which allows the maggots to come out quite quick, even in this real cold temperature. And what I'm going to do, I've put about 10 or 12 maggots in there. I'm just going to dunk the feeder in. That does a few things. It adds a little bit of weight to the feeder, but it also just deadens those maggots a little bit with the cold. So they're not going to come flying out all over the place. Now I'm only fishing a little tiny light feeder, so I'm not going to go cranking the tip right round. I've literally cast out, taken up any slack and left it to it. I'm just going to let that line sink on its own accord. Tiny little weight, zero sort of resistance when a fish picks it up and pulls. Keeping noise to an absolute minimum. I want to keep everything quiet. Like I said earlier, before we started fishing, everything in stealth mode, just keeping everything nice and quiet, camouflaged and quiet, and just letting the fish tell me what's happening. I'll give it, probably leave it out there for 10 minutes, just to see if I get any liners or bites. Normally, if you cast in amongst the ball of these F1s or small carp, you do get an odd little sign. If I don't catch, I can always go further into my peg. I had a tiny, tiny little line of them, which is a fantastic sign. And you see, even though I'm only fishing 010 on this feeder, I'm not holding the rod. I'm keeping the rod away from me. I don't want to be striking at liners by just reacting. As soon as I've got a proper bite, you do get a few dropbacks, but most of them will be pulling the rod round. You can literally just pick the rod up and start playing the fish. It really is a case of not striking, trying to be mindful of the fact and remembering that you're on that light, light hook length. Started on 010 to an 18, and I will drop down. See, I can tell straight away, I can tell that there's a little bit of tow on the lake, purely because the tip's round. I've got the 1 ounce tip in this rod, and the tip is round a little bit, which tells me straight away that there is some tow. And my experience on this lake and other big F1 lakes is that when there's tow, the fish tend to be at distance a little bit. It used to happen at Larford when they first put them in there, and it's happened on a few other lakes. Barston, for instance, tend to be out when there's a little bit of tow. Obviously other venues are slightly different. You've got Tunnel Barn, you've got Westwoods, where they're smaller snake lakes and they don't get affected so much by tow. And I think that's why even in the cold months you can catch loose feeding out your hand, or even in the margins in some venues. But these bigger lakes where you've got a big head of F1 still, they can go out a distance. Also, the way I've gone about things today, it's very, very important. 10 o'clock and 2 o'clock casting my feeder in front of me. That way I've not got my line on my feed rod going through either of my pole rigs. And that sort of thing, when it's cold and clear and you're looking for a handful of fish, to me is vitally, vitally important. Now, although I've got the longer rod and although I've got the power gun, you'll notice that I'm trying not to take my eye off of that rod tip. Because, you know, even when I used to fish 013, 015, you can get broke on the bite. So by fishing light, I'm trying to keep my eye on that tip constantly. That way, as soon as I get an indication that I think is a bite, I can literally just reach down and I've got the rod in my hand. I'm not surprised at the lack of indications. We've had that one indication. I'm not surprised at all, because the water temperature is well, well down and it's typical winter fishing. But I do fully expect to get a bite or two on this, even if I've got to venture out slightly more towards the middle of the lake. But what I'm doing is I'm giving myself options. I've still got my pole lines. I've got still room to go out into my peg on this feeder line if I don't get any bites. Obviously, a question some of you ask, okay, well, when do you start venturing? And normally I'll give it at least two chucks without a bite, 2 8 to 10 minute casts without a bite before I start venturing past my line. I'm always trying to give myself options, always giving the fish an area in my peg where they can settle before I go there. I see so many people this time of year, they feed the pole line and straight away they chuck out 2 meters from the rope and the whole of their peg's got pressure on then. There's nowhere where the fish can actually go and settle. And that to me is a big, big mistake. One of the biggest learning curves for me with F1s, especially in the winter, has been keeping my hand out of the feed. I'm always wanting to feed, always wanting to catapult baiting, throw baiting, cut baiting, to try and make things happen. And I think that's where I was brought up, you know, fishing a lot of natural venues with bream and skimmers and roach, where you need to feed to get them in your peg. Obviously then the carp side of it took over, where you just couldn't feed enough. And F1s, it's quite literally the opposite. By priming pegs and putting bait in, you're just causing damage and driving the fish away from you. If you're not catching on an F1 lake, the biggest bit of advice I can give you is to just neglect lines, just leave them. You've got more chance of the fish turning up where you haven't fed anything than where you have been feeding something. So it really is a case, you know, we've caught 4 or 5 F1s on the pole and a couple of skimmers, and we've hardly fed probably not even 50 or 60 maggots. There you go. First cast on the feeder. And you see then, I wasn't in a hurry to pick the rod up. The rod literally went round 6 inches quick and just dropped back. And it was a case of being mindful all the time that I've got that really light hook length on. So I don't want to pick the rod up and give it the big strike like I would if I was on 022 and a 10 fishing for carp. I'm going to click that backwind off immediately. And just the culmination of the longer rod, that little bit of power gum, and not pulling the fish's head off. Yes, you will get an odd one come off. Yes, you will get broke, but you'll get broke on this lake on 015 or 016. But by concentrating on that rod tip, not striking like a madman when you pick that rod up, and just being respectful to the fish when you're playing them. I go along the lines of very similar to how I play bream when I'm fishing braid direct. When I'm fishing these light hook lengths, if you adopt the same attitude, you're not going to go far wrong. And again, I know we're just practicing and it's not a match, but I'm always thinking to myself, look, if I can get to that 20-25 fish, I'm not going to be far off doing well in this match. Slightly smaller F1, but again, hooked nicely, just in the bottom lip that one, both maggots still on. Absolutely beautiful. So what I'm going to do now is cast back in that same place. And it's probably best I mention that, you know, on those red letter days when you're on a few fish, then I'm not going to move. All the time I'm getting bites, I'm not going to move for the sake of moving. The only thing that's going to make me move is when I'm not getting bites. So again, the same routine. I'm not going to count them to the letter, but around about 6 or 8 maggots. I'm just going to dunk it in the water just to make it slightly heavier and to just dull those maggots down a bit. Out to the marker, and then it hit bottom. And I'm not going to tighten up to it. Any tension on the tip is just purely natural. A little bit of bow in my line where the wind's just caught it a tiny bit, but that's all right. If I get a bite, it's going to pull up and it's going to show me the bite. But also, I don't want to risk moving that feeder by tightening up. I've only got a light feeder. Just fishing nice and delicate and light, and really just letting it fish itself. The line will be sunk in a matter of seconds anyway. I can see it coming in now, even with hardly any tension on the tip. But it's unbelievable how much, you know, when you start fishing these venues regular, how much you can learn. You know, little things like when it's windy, the fish are at distance. When it's flat, the fish are in close. You know, just little tiny things like that that can really stand you in good stead. See the line coming in now. There's about 3-4 metres left to sink. Absolutely perfect. But going back to what I was saying about moving and when do you go further, all the time you're getting bites and liners and indications, don't move. The later you can leave it to when you have to move to get bites, the better it will be. Trust me, it's a case of only moving when you're not getting bites. Obviously, another advantage you got in matches is watching what other people are doing. Obviously, if you start on a pole and it's slow and you can see people playing them on a feeder, you want to be out there, because you can't afford to give people an hour on this style of fishing. You need to be catching fish. You need to be up there with the numbers. But by starting a little bit short and working your way out, you can prolong the life of your peg, so to speak. Like I say, there's nothing worse than going to the extreme, putting pressure on your peg. You catch a few and they're gone and you've got nowhere to go because there's a rope down the middle. You can go left and right, but when there's a few anglers on the lake, you're limited that way as well. You can glean a lot of information from what other people are doing. And what I would be doing now, if it's a match, I've caught a few early fish on the pole, that's gone a little bit. Got on the feeder, caught one. I'm going to be going through the motions as far as going further if the fish just back off a little bit. But also just tapping some baiting on the pole and maybe looking for that last hour and 20 minutes where I can put a few more fish together on the pole. But again, the advantage you've got in a match is being able to look at other people. Oh, he's got one on the pole, he's got one on the pole. Right, I'm going to try the pole because maybe the fish have come into the pole line. Obviously, when you're sat here on your own, you've got to work absolutely everything out on your own. But that is, there you go, there's another fish there. Literally was pulling the rod round like a proper carp would. And I've literally just picked the rod up and there's another fish on. Beautiful fishing. And believe me, by fishing light like this with a balanced rig on the pole and this little bit of power gumming your rig on the feeder enables you to fish light and just get bites when a lot of other people are really struggling. Really is a massive thing in my winter fishing now for these fish. There you go. Not the biggest F1, but again, even fish like this, they all average out at over a pound. Nice small fish, but it's bites. couple of them ones we've caught on the pole have been like 2-2.5 pounds, so they all even themselves out, and it's a numbers game really. So again, what's good is I'm not even thinking about going past, I'm just sticking to the same old line. And you'll notice as well, you know, we fed about less than 20 maggots in those two casts, and it just goes to show that if you can find the fish, you hardly need to feed a thing this time of year. There we go. One other little thing while we're fishing about that power gum is it acts as a little bit of a boom, and it just holds that light hook length away from the feeder, stops any spinning, stops any tangles. It's got its advantages where, yes, you can fish light, it shock absorbs any of those little bit of a ferocious pull that you get off these F1s and that, but also it acts as a boom, it acts as a tangle, you know, an anti-tangle sort of system, and anything that works like that, I'm all for. You'll notice that, you know, when we've reeled in and we're unhooking fish, there's no tangles, there's nothing. Everything works perfectly well. So not only does it give me an advantage as far as not getting snapped off on the bite, it also acts as a little bit of a anti-tangle boom, which, like I say, with these light lines, with normal rigs, you can suffer with a bit of spin, you can suffer with it just twirling around the feeder and creating a little bit of a, you know, a little bit of a messy rig, and this is absolutely perfect. Line's almost sunk now, a couple of meters left. Nice. There we go, there's another one on the feeder. That was a proper bite, almost like a double figure carp. It's not, it's a decent F1 I would have thought. But again, it's just so nice having that security. Changing the angle of the rod, which I don't like to do, but the fish has gone off a bit to the left. As long as you do it nice and slow on those small hooks, you shouldn't have a problem with the hook slipping. You might be able to hear an odd little click, and that's just my clutch just slipping. I've got it again, just every little bit of little security that I can have, I'm using. Nice F1. Again, I'm not rushing. Just bring it to the net nice and steady. The last match in these conditions, £31 won the lake. So you can see why I'm not really pulling the fish's head off or anything. I'm just trying to make every single one count. What I'm going to do now, because it's been a little while on the pole, I'm just going to tap a few maggots in. One brilliant little tip when you're doing this, when you're feeding quick, is to not take your rig off. Because I'm using a tiny little hook, I can leave the hook on, ship straight out, rattle a few maggots in, come back and put it down. I don't run the risk of tangling my rig or anything like that. The rig is still attached to the pole, out to my marker, nice and high. Drop a few maggots in and then I'm back, and by leaving that hook I can literally just drop my top kit and I'm back in. It's all about, although you're not getting hundreds of bites, you still want to be as fast and efficient as you possibly can. I just want to talk about something that I think is vitally important when you're fishing with maggots, and that's hooking them. You just want to literally just nick them so that you're there hooked as lightly as possible. Obviously you don't want them to just fall off, so you do need to hook them with a little bit of authority. But try not to hook them like really deep. Try to just nick them, and that way they maintain as much movement and life in them as possible. One little thing that I'm not doing is obviously setting a timer. It's not like we're leaving it out there half hour, 40 minutes for carp. I just take a little glimpse at my watch, just to check, and I'm leaving it out there, if I don't get a bite, around about 8 to 10 minutes. I'm not feeding hardly anything, like I say, 6 to 8 to 10 maggots maybe at the most at a time in this feeder. So it's not a case of putting in a lot of bait and just waiting. It's a case of I'm just putting in, you know, the minimal amount. I'm just looking to keep it all ticking over. Hopefully if this wind drops, we can catch a few more on the pole later on. But, you know, it's just about trying to read the peg, read what the lake's doing, and altering with it, and just keep fish going in the net, even if it's only odd fish. Obviously, if you could pick one thing to have in fishing, it would probably be hindsight. If only I knew this, if only I knew that. Now, the nearest thing I've got to having hindsight in fishing is using a thermometer to take the water temperature. I can come up with a few different examples of when it's really paid off for me taking the water temperature. But it's not just me, other people take the water temperature at different venues, and you get to learn that there's certain temperatures when pellets work, there's certain temperature when it's maggots, there's certain temperatures when it's very, very difficult, certain temperature when dobbing bread can work, and it really is the nearest thing to hindsight. But possibly the best example happened to me last year at Old Berry Hill. I was fishing a match there, got to the draw, having something to eat in the hut, and word on the street was at the draw that it was going to be terrible. We've had northerly winds all week. The water temperature's freezing. No one had actually taken the temperature, mind you. So I got to my peg with all of this ringing in my ears. It's going to be hard. It's going to be terrible. £10 will be a good weight. So I set up my normal setup of a couple of pole rigs, accompanied by a short feeder and two feeders for long. Obviously thinking it's going to be hard, small hooks, long hook lengths were the order of the day. Tiny little feeders, I don't want to feed too much. While I was doing this, I actually had my thermometer in the water. And I was quite pleasantly surprised to see that it was nearly 8 degrees. Everyone was talking about 4s and 5s, but it was nearly 8. So a quick change around before the match started to bigger feeders, bigger hooks, shorter hook lengths, more positive approach, saw me actually, you know, absolutely dominate the area I was in. Weighing in 29 pounds and anglers either side of me fishing negative, not catching at all, and really not having any fish in their pegs after I'd attacked it at the start and put more bait in. So as you can see, that's one of the reasons, just one example, why I'm a massive fan of taking the water temperature, because it is the nearest thing to, you know, hindsight that I can actually, you know, can say. Bit like Wednesday, the match on gold, I had 113 pound, caught half my fish on a waggler. I know that 7.5 degrees or more, there you go, oh, might have been that coot, that one actually. But going back to, it's a little bit like Wednesday, you can see there I've reeled that in. Absolutely not marked. I'm going to put 2 fresh maggots in. But going back to the thermometer, I know anything 7.5 degrees and over. And on the other lakes here at Gold Valley, you can catch some fish on a big waggler with a little yellow wafter, just cast out into the middle of the lake. Wednesday, I put my thermometer in. It was 7.4. Halfway through the match, it had gone up to 7.6. And a change to a waggler saw me catch 5 in the last hour, which was the difference between me, I actually came second, but it's a difference between me framing and not. A thermometer for me is a must. I use a digital one, I can show you it there, it's still in there now, you can see 5.8, it's actually gone up 0.4. Reuben Heaton, they're available from a lot of tackle shops, aquariums, places like that. But it really is an invaluable piece of kit. Just got a lead of about 6 foot long that you put in, and it comes up with the reading on the screen. It's not like the ones that you have to read with the mercury and all this that, you know, can be a little bit misleading and difficult to read 100% accurate. It tells you exactly what the temperature is, on a digital screen, and it's absolutely foolproof. Just got a leaf or something floating there that my line had gone under. Now, we haven't had a bite for a couple of casts, and what I'm thinking now, I'm going to leave it there about 8 minutes. If I don't catch, I'm going to peel off a couple of metres, feed my pole line again, and then go back on the feeder. But I will be fishing, like I say, a couple of metres past. By starting where we started on the feeder, it gives me the opportunity to back off those 2 metres probably 4 or 5 times before I'm eventually at the rope. It's a real good little trick and a fantastic way of keeping a few fish coming on these cold, cold days. Right, so it's been out there about 10 minutes now, no more bites, and it's time now to start backing off a little bit. So all I'm going to do now, I've got my clip there, unclip it 4 times to the first eye, just over 2 metres, but that's how much I like to back off at a time. Bring that in, and then what I'm going to do is just tap a few maggots on my pole to keep that going, and then go back on the feeder. But I will be casting, like I say, those 2 metres further. Just a brilliant, brilliant way of just keeping a few fish coming. You'll notice as well on the pole, when I'm topping up, I'm just feeding one side. Because if I do go on the pole and there's a few fish there, I know that I've still got that other line all ready to go. But what I don't want to do is be putting, again, pressure on my peg, baiting 2 areas. I'm just really feeling my way into catching a handful of fish. Now, it wouldn't surprise me now, venturing past, if I'm, you know, get a bite within a matter of minutes, because, like I say, quite often when there's an odd fish about, by just going past you get an instant reaction. Maybe not, because it is an absolutely bitterly cold day, but it can be quite an instant thing by going just past. There you go. Just those 2 metres further. I relate it a lot to pole fishing, where the fish can just back off just past the pole tip. It's exactly the same with the feeder. And just by venturing out nice and slowly, letting the fish tell you when it's time to go past, when you've had a couple of those 8 to 10 minute casts with no bites, then start to move. Let the fish tell you this time of year exactly when it's time. But normally when you back off, you can get a bite. There you go. And that is exactly what happens, and that is why you've got to leave yourself places to go in your peg. Biggest mistake I see people making is they go to the extremes of their pegs and they don't give themselves anywhere to go. And what's just happened there, us backing off those 2 metres casting, it's literally been in there probably a minute and the tip's round, and that's just a fish that's just on the outskirts of where we've been casting, thinks it's safe. You just unclip and go that bit further and bang. And again, it's just about repeating the same process. You might get one next chuck and next chuck, and then it goes a bit funny. Give yourself those couple of casts without a bite. If it happens again, then you can just go 2 metres further and start the whole process again. It's a brilliant way of putting those 15, 20 fish in the net on these bitterly cold days. Again, just taking my time. Remembering all the time that we're only on that light hook length. Another nice F1. Lovely. And that just goes to show you how valuable it is backing off past your line. Like I say, we'd had at least 2 chucks of 8 to 10 minutes, so close to 20 minutes fishing without a sign. Absolutely brilliant fishing. I absolutely love fishing when you're catching fish and you're understanding why, and more importantly, you can watch other anglers fish in a certain way and you can understand exactly why they're not catching. There you go. That wind's really getting up now, southwesterly. Bitterly cold, but all the time you're getting bites, it's just fantastic. So again, we caught that fish immediately. I've had a little indication, and for that 20 minutes when we were fishing 2 meters short, there wasn't a sign. Really is, I just love it when you can underline things, you can go and prove things. And what we've done in the last 5 minutes by just going that little bit further just underlines and proves to me the importance of having a place in your peg where you can back off to. Not only where you can back off to, but where the fish feel safe, where there's not been a feeder land, where there's not line going through it, where there hasn't been a fish caught, where there's no bait, where the fish just back off and they just feel happy and they stay there, and you can just venture into that area bit by bit and keep a few fish coming. What I would expect now is to catch, you know, two or three or four fish, then it might go a bit quiet, and then I look to back off again. One of the biggest things you've got to do is you've got to be very careful not to move too soon and exhaust your peg, but not to move too late so you sit there for a long period of time not catching. I always give it the two cast rule. If I have two casts without an indication or a bite, then I'm going to move. And it really has stood me in good stead. So you're looking at like 20 minutes without a bite or a liner. Just underlines it, gives it time. Because sometimes you might hook one and it creates a bit of disturbance and the fish back off, and then they will come back. But if nothing happens really in 20 minutes, then it is time to start looking at just going past. As you can see, you know, I'm hardly filling the feeder. I'm putting about, at the most, 10 maggots in at a time. Obviously, that particular feeder is the smallest maggot feeder that Drennan do. You could probably get 25, 30 maggots in it if you cram them in. But that's too many. I know how I'm fishing the pole. I know feeding 6, 7, 10 maggots at a time is more than enough and I can catch fish. So a bit like I said earlier, I'm mimicking what I'm going to do on the pole on the feeder. I know how to feed it on the pole. I know when I feed more, it's derogatory and I stop catching. I know when I feed less, I don't get fish in my peg. So what's right on the pole for me is right on the feeder. That's why I'm trying to mimic numbers of maggots and backing off, a bit similar to like we would do on the pole. But certainly, numbers of maggots is really, I'm going to do exactly the same as what I think's dead right on the pole. There's a couple of other things on the feeder. There we go. Again, just a little lift. The rod was round then. Again, hammering round, but I'm convinced that little bit of power gum and the softer rod, it's a little bit like, you know, with fish sometimes, the harder you pull, the harder they pull back. And I think the length of the rod and the softness of the rod, coupled with that power gum, really takes the sting out of it for the fish, and they don't pull as hard as they might well do on a shorter rod and line direct. But like I was just about to say, there's a couple of other things on the feeder. As far as twitching the feeder and that, I'm not a great fan of this, and the reason for this is simple. A lot of lakeside fish, the bottom's very soft, it's silty, and by dragging that feeder along the bottom, you create that little plume of silt kicked up, and I don't want to do that. I'm literally casting the feeder out and I'm leaving it where it lands. Being nice and patient. Feels like a half decent fish. This could even be a bream. Again, just taking my time. Don't think it is a bream. No, nice big F1. Lovely. They're the ones we want. And like I said earlier, you know, you catch a small one and then you catch a decent one, and they do level themselves out at around about a pound and a half a piece in there. Beautiful fish, absolutely hammered the rod round. But like I say, with the rig we're using, never in any doubt, even on 010 fluorocarbon hook length. Got so much security in this rig with the extra length of the rod and the clutch set on the reel, that 5 inches of power gum. So again, just dunk the feeder in. Yeah, so going back to what I was saying, as far as twitching the bait, I'm not a fan of this. I never ever have been. Don't want to cause any unwanted or unneeded disturbance, especially with these F1s, because you know they're a fish that live off bottom. When they go to the bottom, they pick bait up, they come back up, and any kind of haze or any kind of mud stirred up, you know, they're not really a massive fan of this. And I've seen people twitching their feeders, and don't get me wrong, on some venues, for instance, where I fish in, another one there, you see just by backing off, all of a sudden, we've literally just increased our catch rate, but it could easily just go, just fizzle out again, but we've still got probably at least 10 metres of our peg to go on. We can back off, and it's a brilliant feeling, you know, in these matches when you're catching fish and you still haven't exhausted your peg. You've got places to go, you know if you don't get a bite next chuck or next chuck, you unclip another 2 meters, cast out, and you never know for sure, but you've got a pretty good idea that you're going to start getting bites again. One thing, if you're going to, you know, give this a go, go out and have a little practice before you do fish really light in matches. Just get used to picking the rod up and not striking. Not the biggest F1. Just go out and have a practice fishing with these real light lines. It can take a little bit of getting used to. And the last thing you really want to do is be trying it for the first time in a match. You want to go out, have a little practice. Hook just inside. Lovely fishing. You'll notice then that I just hesitated slightly. And although the maggots are very good quality and they're all very good and big, but I always like to just pick out those slightly bigger ones. Don't know why, it's just something that my dad taught me when we were fishing the rivers when I was really young. You know, those bigger maggots, those ones that have just got that little bit more movement to them, are just going to be a bit more appealing to the fish. And it's always stood me in good stead. Obviously, we spoke about twitching the bait, we've spoken about casting. You know, the only other thing really with the feeder, you know, people might say, well, why have you cut a little slit in your feeder? And again, going back to the pole, you notice that I don't tip them all, the maggots, in one little pile. I sprinkle them out. And just then, and it just reminded me when I watched that feeder land, as the feeder landed, I literally saw a couple of other maggots just land around the feeder. And again, what I'm creating, or what I'm trying to do, is mimic what I'm doing on the pole. And just by cutting that little slit out of the feeder, as the feeder hits the clip and stops, a couple of maggots just ping out, and you get that little bit of a spread that can just hold a few fish. So it's about thinking about it all the time. And I've always been a massive fan of taking on board, you know, if I know how to feed it on the pole and I know what bait's working, then I'm not 99.9% sure that that'll be the way to do it on the feeder, or as near as damn it as I can do it. And I've always been a massive fan of that. Well, there we go, there's another one. Since I've gone past those 2 meters, it really has been a fish every single cast. And again, it just goes to show that, you know, don't move unless you have to. At the moment, you know, if this was a match, could well just finish off not having to move again. And that's the beauty of fishing like this. You're only moving as and when you have to, and the fish are going to tell you when. You might have noticed I've got a coat on now. It is bitterly, bitterly cold. The wind's got up and it is absolutely freezing. But it certainly hasn't put the fish off. I'm going to give the pole another go in a minute just to see if... I fed it probably three or four times, every 25 minutes, half hour. Just shook a few maggots in. And I'm going to give it a go in a minute just to see if any fish have rocked up there. But the feeder really is one every single cast at the moment. And I think, you know, not only going further has really turned the fish on, but having left it at the beginning of the session for as long as we did, the fish are really nice size F1s, but the fish are really settled and they obviously feel at home there without putting pressure on the rest of our peg. The day's turned into a really, really good one. There we go, we've got another fish on the pole. Seems to be an odd fish there now, but it's that time of day where the light's starting to go. Another decent F1. If it was a match, probably wouldn't have come off the feeder because it was absolutely solid out there. But I just had it in my mind, you know, these sort of days, I just want to try things, and just goes to show that when that light starts to go, that even on the coldest of days, fishing nice and light, you can get some bites on the pole, on the feeder. But I think if it was a match, there's no way we'd have come off that feeder because it was literally one every chuck. The only thing I can say is the fish are definitely that little bit bigger on the pole. Not had a small F1 on the pole. They've all been decent size. And that could just be a confidence thing, or, you know, these slightly bigger ones think that they're just that little bit cleverer, so they come in, I don't know. But, you know, that's the sort of average size one on the pole, whereas the ones on the feeder, although there seems to be a few more, are definitely on the smaller side. Well, there we go, we've reached the end of the session. Bitterly, bitterly cold now. That wind's picked up, sun's gone down, and it is absolutely freezing. But what a brilliant day. Caught a few to begin with on the pole, and then the wind got up and the fish just seemed to move out. Went on a feeder, caught two or three immediately, then backed off 2 metres, and it was really good, a bite every chuck. Some of them quite quick, virtually as the feeder was hitting the bottom. Which, when the temperature's not gone above 5.8, the water temperature that is, I think it's been fantastic. Came back in on the pole late on after a little bit of not regular feeding but just trundling like 10 or 12 maggots in every half hour. Went in there and caught 6 or 7 half decent ones as well. It's noticeable that the bigger fish were definitely on the pole line. Did catch a couple of better ones on the feeder, but all in all, on average, they were a little bit smaller. But I think it's gone to show today that, one, not putting pressure on the whole of your peg, leaving it for as long as you can, but backing off at the right time. There's definitely fish coming all day. And it just goes to show that, you know, some people, when they put pressure on their peg from the word go in a match, i.e. cast to the rope, feed the pole lines, there's nowhere for the fish to go apart from in other people's pegs. And if you sort of play the game the way that I've showed you to today, you can quite often end up with a peg full of fish, even on freezing cold days like today. coupled with fishing light, incorporating the power gum into your feeder rig, and all in all, you've got quite a deadly approach. It's only about drawing near some fish, and then you're going to be very, very hard to beat. Just go over a couple of other things that I think are vitally important that we have mentioned today. Is one, when it comes time to come off the pole and go on the feeder, don't prime your line up. Don't go put in a pot full of bait and just leave it, almost neglect it, and there's more chance of those F1s turning up. As far as the bream are concerned, we've caught two or three, they're just mixed in. They're a welcome addition, but what I'm not going to do is target the bream by putting bait in, a lot of bait, like micro pellets or ground bait. I'm going to target the F1s, and whatever bream I catch are an added bonus. Keep it light, keep it so that you've got places to go in your peg. Even with an hour to go, half hour to go, you want to be thinking, well, I can always cast there and maybe I'll get a few fish. Don't exhaust your peg and don't push it to the limits early on. It stood me in good stead. I've won a lot of matches here this season, fishing the way that I've shown you today. Don't be afraid to fish light. Go out and give it a go when it's not a match. Get used to it. Get used to just picking the rod up and playing the fish. You'll be very, very hard to beat. It stood me in good stead, and it's 100% caught me a lot of fish when other people around me have been struggling. So all in all, it's been a fantastic day. Let's get the fish out and have a look what we've managed to catch. Well, there you go. They're the fish we caught, probably around 50, 55 pound. Fantastic day. We probably would have caught a few more if we'd have just stayed on the feeder. But these bigger F1s were definitely on the pole line. You can see they're real nice fish. Two and a half pound. Real chunky fish. One real gorgeous one there, almost like a fully scaled. Fantastic fishing. Fishing light and giving ourselves options. That's the main thing. Always leave yourself somewhere to go. Have a little practice at fishing light before you actually employ those tactics in a match, because it does take a little bit of getting used to. But I think on a freezing cold day you can see for yourself just how well my approach has worked and the tackle that we've used today. All in all, an absolutely fantastic day, but I am absolutely frozen. I hope you can put all the tricks I've shown you to good use, especially the little feeder trick.